Despite the recent twists and turns within the economy, the move by government to announce that no new taxes would be levied on the 2022-23 national budget was welcomed by analysts. They say that businesses struggled through the pandemic era and any hope to boost recovery is very much acknowledged. Well, the countdown is on for passing the national budget and we wait to see the sectorial allocations. You're watching The Business Show. Welcome. Here now are stories that made the business week. Civil society organizations petition Parliament over coffee deal. Fitch gives Stanbic positive credit rating. NSSF holds 2022 Career Expo at Motive. And Russia holds gas exports to Poland and Bulgaria.
Asking for salary increment now in the middle of a crisis from your employer will make you a candidate for unemployment.
A cow needs comfort.
Now, when the economy was fully opened post-COVID-19, there's a lot of recovery hopes, especially for businesses that had struggled during the lockdown. But months later, sudden shocks such as fuel and commodity rising prices have rocked in, and spending power by consumers also dwindled, and now we are registering higher operational costs. On Views from the Top this week, John Walugembe from the Federation for Small and Medium Enterprises analyzes the road to recovery and also could the looming Kenyan election have an impact on Uganda's economy.
To the general sense, there has been a general sense of being upbeat. The economy has been on a firm road to recover. Of course, it's been slow. Not that we expected it to be any faster, but it's been a slow recovery. But we see certain sectors, not at the pandemic levels, but almost there. You know, if you look at the retail sector, if you look at the wholesale sector, if you look at certain sections of the manufacturing sector, those have tended to do well. On the other hand, the sectors that are struggling, if you look at the tourism sector in particular, it's struggling for some time. The education sector was just like a tourism sector, but the reopening of schools was a timely shot that has helped this sector to kind of pick up. So it's a mixed picture, but I would say overall, you see an economy that's on a firm road to recovery, and there's been a lot of optimism. Obviously, we're experiencing some shocks here and there, but overall, I would say that the economy is on a road to recovery, and businesses are similarly learning to cope, and I would say that couple of months or years for some, they'll hit their pre-pandemic level of economic activity. Well, you need to look at the impacts that COVID-19 had. One, you had an impact on supply chains, the disruptions of supply chains, and some firms had to diversify the sourcing of their inputs from Southeast Asia to the region. So that is disruptive and impacts on the ability for these manufacturing entities to operate at full capacity. Similarly, there was also the issue of layoffs. The pandemic led many firms to lay off their workers. So it's not like a switch that once the economy is reopened, you hire everyone again, because demand has to pick up. You can't hire people if demand is picking up slowly. So this really will explain the sluggishness in the sector. There's also been an increase in transportation charges. If you look at freight costs, those are still high because COVID-19 is still affecting certain parts of the world. If you look at China, Shanghai is still locked down. So the freight charges and the ability to access critical inputs are still causing a bit of disruption to certain manufacturing establishments.
Okay, let's talk about shocks now. And within a few months before Kenya goes into elections,
yes.
And we sometimes, or we really know that once there is a bit of uncertainty. You know, we're not saying it's going to happen.
Yeah.
But should it happen, we're already seeing fear.
Yes.
Over the, you know, the possible market. So
yes.
First of all, let's start with Kenya.
Yes.
And the elections. Mm. What does this bring for us and our recovery agenda?
So the Kenyan election is an interesting one. You know, when you have an incumbent, it's easy to predict who will win because you have an incumbent with a bit of advantages going into an election. This time you have they are not new players in politics, but none of them has been the president before. So it means that the election is quite contentious, and we've already seen signs that this might be a very hotly contested election. So I would say that Uganda needs to prepare for any outcome. We obviously hope that it will be a peaceful election and that we won't have any security incidents, particularly those that would disrupt our access to our port. But in case that happens, we need to prepare. So it means we need to stock our fuel reserves. It means we need to look at accessing the sea through the central corridor. And we need to look at alternatives, how we can alleviate the potential siege in case the situation in Kenya gets out of control. So I would just urge our decision makers to use this time to plan. It shouldn't appear as if it's a catastrophe, yet it's one that we could have foreseen and averted. Firstly, we have to explain to businesses what's causing this, so they understand, because there's not been much clarity in explaining what is the cause of this current situation. I'd say the current situation is largely driven by external factors. The high price of global crude oil has almost doubled, due of course to the disruptions of COVID-19, but very recently due to the conflict between Ukraine and Russia. So that's one. Two, the lack of planning on our part. We don't have sufficient strategic national oil reserves. So it means it makes it difficult for Uganda to stabilize the price. Yes, even if the price globally of a barrel of crude oil has doubled, however, if we had strategic fuel reserves, would find a way of stabilizing the price on the local market, which we don't have. The other way is that there has also been a bit of cartelish behavior on behalf of some local actors who have sought to benefit from this unfortunate situation. And because we've not been very firm in terms of regulation, it has allowed some of these actors to get away with these kinds of actors. So I think most of the issues are external. There's also some internal components in the problem. But I think should be able to stabilize soon if all those factors are addressed. Yes.
So there's this popular talk of the business owners or employers should look at better payments for their employees, given the tougher times now in terms of expenditure. Is it something you subscribe to?
Well, these guys need to understand that we are in a capitalistic economy. This is not a socialist republic. So in a capitalistic economy, it means that first of all, you have to reward the owners of capital. Who are the business owners? So the business owner must get his return on capital because he has borrowed money from somewhere or he has used his own equity to start running this business. So he must get his reward somehow. This is the objective. Now, in times such as these, where the prices for fuel are going through the roof, particularly diesel, it means that the cost of production is increasing. The cost of producing a product or delivering a service is increasing. Now, ideally, the consumer should be charged more, but we know what consumers are going through. Most of them have lost jobs, incomes are unstable, and so on. So it means business owners have to go through a very difficult time to cut costs. Now, one of those costs is staff. And that's why you see a lot of people losing their jobs at this time. Now, those people who have jobs should be grateful to God that they still have them. Asking for such increment now in the middle of a crisis from your employer will make you a candidate for unemployment, in my view. Not that what you desire is not a good thing. I mean, everyone would want to get a pay raise, crisis or no crisis. But during a crisis, the business owner has to make tough choices, as I've said. And some businesses obviously can afford to increase salaries, some can't. Okay, so I wouldn't really encourage this talk of asking employers to bear the burden of subsidizing the lifestyle of their workers. If government gave tax relief to businesses and urged them to increase salaries for workers, I think this would be an excellent move, but that is not the case. So businesses cannot be expected to bear the brunt of such crisis. So my view, therefore, is workers should be more understanding. It's difficult because inflation is a tax, not just on the business owners, but also on ordinary employees. You know, because what you used to, if you bought 5 bunches of matoke last month, with rise in inflation, it means you can only buy 3 or 2. You know, so it means you're losing money somehow. You're losing money. Okay? So it's a tough situation, we understand, but we need to see how employees and employers engage in a more, bit of dialogue and understanding to get through this crisis. And trying to use unions and apply pressure to increase salaries, I think, is not be the best way forward.
Had from grant the 2022-23 budget won't have new taxes.
Yeah.
Is it something that creates a bit of, you know, hope or a bit of relaxing for the taxpayers?
Yeah, I mean, it's a good thing that, you know, if government keeps introducing taxes everywhere, you create a very unpredictable business environment. You know, when investors or business people are planning to choose, they come up with, are choosing which place to invest, they conduct an assessment. They conduct an assessment of the taxation regime. They see which taxes you charge, you know, they look at your corporation tax rate, they look at your pay as you earn rate, they look at your VAT rate, and then they choose to invest. Now, if each year you keep throwing a new tax in the mix, it means you're creating a lot of instability. So it's a good thing for our taxes and our tax regime to be fairly predictable. So the fact that government is choosing not to introduce taxes, I think, is a good thing.
There is no doubt that all the eyes will be on the Kenyan election, and considering what happened in 2017, staying forearmed as a country could save us another economic shock. Thank you very much for watching. The Business Show is taking a break, but we return shortly with so much more.